to say Cars.com's editors think that home charging is important for EV ownership would be an understatement. We believe it's essential. Now, I promised the producers I would not get into nerdy details about how electric car chargers like this one are not technically chargers in the traditional sense, but we did figure you'd probably want to know what distinguishes the different chargers from each other should you find yourself in a position to acquire one for your EV. And you might also wonder why you even need this thing. You're buying the car, why do you have to spend more money on this thing? You've never had to deal with that before when you bought a conventional car. Why isn't there just a cord that you can plug into an outlet? Look, here's an outlet. Why is this thing in the middle? And why am I paying for it? We'll get into that. But first, I want to clarify one thing. When we talk about home charging for a battery electric car with hundreds of miles of range, we are talking about level 2 home charging. Level 2 means 240 volts or 220 volts. These are interchangeable terms. Don't get confused by that. The reason you need that is because 120 volts, or 110 if you call it that, which we're all familiar with, is not enough for an electric car. Every EV comes with what we usually call a trickle charger like this, a little box, the same connector, and the familiar plug. This is good for only 5 miles of range for every hour of charging, and that is on an efficient, small EV. An SUV might be 3 miles of range. That is clearly not enough if you've got a battery pack that can give you hundreds of miles of range. So you need 240 volts of charging, what's called level 2. Now there's another reason that we recommend level 2 that you might not see reported that frequently, and that is because when it comes to driving an electric car, there's another way that it's different from driving a conventional car, and really there aren't that many. You drive an electric car like you drive a normal car. But when you leave home or wherever you're charging, it's best to have the cabin preconditioned, that is pre-cooled or preheated, because electric cars use electric air conditioning and electric heat. And the only source of electricity is the battery, and that's where your range comes from. So if you get in your car in the winter and it's frigid and you immediately turn the heat on, you're instantly robbing your range. So it's best to preheat the car when it's still connected to grid power. And this is something that EVs let you do either by scheduling it for your departure time in the car or by using an app or sometimes using the key fob just like you might remote start a conventional gas-powered car, or they may have an app that lets you do it like our Ford Mustang Mach-E here does. I'm holding the start button and it will start. So the lights flash. The fans are on, the air conditioning's running because it's warm where we're shooting this. And this is an important step if you want to maintain your range anytime you depart from home, and you need 240 volts to do this. In our experience, 120 volts is not enough to run the air conditioning or the heat in the most extreme temperatures without dipping into the battery power. So there's two reasons you want level 2 if you buy a battery electric car. Now, I promised I'd explain why you need this thing. And the reason for the charging systems is safety and compatibility. It's there to protect both you and the vehicle. Now, if you think about it, 120, 240 volts is a lot to be holding in your hand. And that is the main reason that the charging system like this exists. There is no high voltage in this cable until it's connected to the car. And that's important because some of these installations will be outside. Not everyone has their charger in the garage. You may have it on the side of your house. And the system is pretty much what you will find in public as well. Level 2 charging in public is essentially the same hardware. If you're in the rain or standing in a puddle or something like that, you don't want electricity. What happens is you go to plug it in. When you plug in, the car and the charger communicate with each other. The charger tells the car how much power it can provide. Then the charger is ready to send power, and it throws a switch internally, a big relay called a contactor, which you can usually hear, and then it energizes the cable, but only when it's connected. We'll see if we can hear it. little click there. Now, power is flowing and charging has started. So it is a safety feature. It protects you, and it also protects the car from arcing and stuff like that. Same thing is true when you release it. As soon as you press this button, you hear that click? That means high voltage has been shut off. It's not in the cable anymore. So there's the safety aspect. The other, as I mentioned, is compatibility. Compatibility matters because this connector will work with any vehicle aside from a Tesla that has the same connector. It doesn't matter if it's a different brand. It doesn't matter if the charger has more or less power. You can't put too much power into the car. The car and the charger talk to each other. They work it out. You actually might want to think about having more power than you need and future-proof your installation. You might end up with a bigger, more power-hungry SUV in the future. These are durable items that should last many years. Why not invest a little bit more now, and then you'll be ready for the future. As it regards compatibility, I did mention Tesla. Tesla is the other type of connector. Tesla has its own. Every other current EV uses this type, which unfortunately is named J1772. If the connector fits your car, it will work. You don't have to worry about that at all. While I'm talking about compatibility, also know, because it's a standard, that brand doesn't matter. You don't need a Ford charger for a Ford EV like this. Now, having said that, here's a surprise. There are a couple manufacturers, Ford included, following the lead of Tesla, that provide for free with the purchase of the car what is actually a combination level one, level two charger with interchangeable plugs. This is a 240 volt plug. And what that means is you don't necessarily have to invest more in hardware, just the installation or just the outlet. And I think that's a great move because they know you have to pay at least some to get the circuit installed. And this is a pretty robust 32 amps of current. Now, I wish I could get into the details on that too. Different levels of current will provide different speeds of charging at level two. Level two sounds like one thing. It's actually not one thing. It's many things. It could be you're adding less than 10 miles of range per hour to more than 30 miles of range per hour, depending on the amp rating. We do have more detail if you look at the provided links. If your EV doesn't come with level two charging, or you want to charge faster than the provided unit can accomplish, you're going to have to choose a charger. So this happens to be Cars.com's first level two charger. It's about 10 years old. Things haven't changed that much functionally. We have since upgraded with mostly more powerful units. Most of our reviewers now have home charging. We have Clipper Creek, Juice Box, Wall Box, Charge Point, and the one behind me, which is an Electrify America Electrify Home unit, which is a new product. We have very detailed information on this in our charger buying guide at Cars.com News. I recommend you look at it. So what makes them different? One of the things you're going to find is sometimes they are hardwired to the wall, and sometimes they have the plug, which is why we chose this location. What are the advantages of the plug? Well, for one thing, if you can, you know, go to another location that has an outlet, you can take this with you and plug it in there. Maybe you have a summer home or a relative who has an outlet you can use. Maybe you're a renter and you're fortunate enough to have an outlet at your disposal. When it's time for you to leave, maybe your lease is up and it's time to skedaddle, it's easier to just pull it and go without calling an electrician. Prices slightly higher for a unit with a plug, and installation for an outlet might be slightly higher as well. Hardwiring is tidier looking, and sometimes it's required. If you go to 48 amps or higher of current rating on the charger, it has to be hardwired. And also outdoors, some municipalities won't let you use an outlet because of weather considerations. So those are some of the things you're gonna have to bear in mind. So another big differentiator, at least nowadays, is whether the charger is networked or not. And you can still get either type. If it's not networked, it's simple. You plug it in and it charges. The network type allows you to control charging, monitor charging, sometimes keep track of how much energy you've used all through a smartphone app. Now, This adds cost to the charger, typically. And so you know, every EV I can think of today has this feature as well. So you can schedule it to charge when power is cheaper in some areas overnight, off peak, or keep an eye on charging and start and stop it via the car. So you don't necessarily need your charging unit to do this, but it is available and it's a distinguishing factor among the products. And one of the other big things that distinguishes chargers from each other is the amount of power they provide to the car, which of course affects charging speed. And typically, the more powerful the charger, the more expensive it's going to be. Some of them will give you a particular maximum level, and others might actually be adjustable for different circuit levels. That'll add a little price too. You might even be able to change that charging speed using an app on your phone if it's a networked unit. There are many different things to look at. We cover it in much more detail. I wish I could do it here. At Cars.com News, I recommend you look at it. Whatever charger you choose, you're going to arrive at that decision with the help of an electrician. And you're almost certainly going to need some kind of installation work, which can be complicated and potentially costly. So what we did is we put together an animation that'll help you understand some of the obstacles you might run into. And this will help you decide whether it's even a good idea to get an EV in the first place, or at least understand what the electrician is talking about when you get your estimate.